Hello and welcome to another weekly service here, online service at St. Paul's United Church. I'm Reverend Dale Skinner, and I want to welcome you to this time, and I hope that this time of worship is something that feeds your soul and can lift your spirit through this time, this pandemic time that continues to move on. And, you know, I'm amazed in some respects, you know, and I've heard this from others, how, you know, there's a sense through this pandemic time that the days kind of drag a little, but then you look back and you wonder, you know, why time is passing so quickly. It's certainly a different awareness, and it reminds me that we're all in a different space right now, spiritually, you know, emotionally, mentally. And it certainly is something to be aware of. And I hope that through this time, you know, that we continue to be the church and to do the work of the church for one another's in whatever way we can as we continue to adapt to the new reality that we find ourselves within. And I know moving forward, we're hopeful that we'll move to, again, to live worship. You know, we're working on putting some certain protocols in place, maybe having a setup in the sanctuary that will allow for, you know, no hymn books and no bulletins, because we can't allow for much surface contact and these sorts of things as we continue to follow protocols around social distancing, you know, and sanitary conditions, and of course wearing face masks when possible. We're going to do whatever we can to make sure that when we do have live worship, that people feel as comfortable as they can. We're going to try to make things as safe as we can, and also to be as accessible as we can, so people can at least have a meaningful worship experience. And yes, it'll take time to get used to some of the new changes, but hopefully we will adapt, and we will make the best of this situation, and really continue to be the church for each other, and to inspire one another through our presence and our participation in the body of Christ. I hope that wherever you are, that you are keeping well as you can. To anyone out there who may be having a celebration at this time of year, a birthday, or perhaps an anniversary, a special congratulations to you. I know that it continues to be different how we celebrate. I actually officiated a wedding last weekend, my first COVID wedding. There was nobody present with COVID, but it was a wedding, you know, where we were required to wear masks in certain places and distance. And the wedding was for Ryan and Catherine Tyrer. And Ryan is the son of Karen and Brent Tyrer. And so congratulations to them on their marriage. And we wish them all the best and hold them in our prayers. And if you have any pastoral news, birthdays, and so on that you would like to for me to share, please pass that along to me either by email or by phone. I remain available, and I would be happy to share it. And again, thank you for the ways you continue to support the life and the work of the church financially. Those gifts are greatly appreciated and do make a big difference through this time. And a big thank you again to, members of our property committee, members of our facility use committee, members of our council and so forth, who are putting in that extra mental energy and that extra effort and physical energy to keep things going. So God bless you. And certainly we will find our way through this, not alone, but together and by God's grace. And friends, it's time to celebrate that grace in our lives as we worship this week. And so let us now turn our attention to God and let us worship God today. Please join me in our call to worship based on Psalm 67. May God be merciful to us and bless us. May God smile with kindness upon us, that everyone on the earth will learn to follow, and all nations will see God's power to save. Let the people praise you, O God. Let all the people everywhere praise you. May the whole earth celebrate and sing for joy, because you judge with integrity and guide all people near and far. Let the people praise you, O God. Let all the people everywhere praise you. Our God has richly blessed us, providing abundantly for all our needs. May God continue to bless us, and may the whole world come to know and worship our God. Let us now turn our hearts and minds to God in prayer. I invite you to bow your head and to take a deep breath, to open your heart, to open your mind, and let us pray. O holy God, with open arms you welcome all who call on your name, who acknowledge you as Lord and look to you in faith. No one stands outside the circle of your mercy and love. And so as we come to offer you our worship this day, to declare that you are our God and that we are your people, called and chosen by you from the very beginning, through the presence of your Holy Spirit, open our eyes to see you here. Open our minds to receive your truth, and our mouths to speak and declare your praise. For you alone are God, worthy of all praise and worship, now and to the end of time. And as we gather, we do so joining our voices in the prayer of your Son, the one who taught his followers to pray, saying, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven.
Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Through Matthew's Gospel, Jesus in his preaching often challenges his hearers to learn the ways of God's grace. One of the things Jesus seeks to teach his followers is that the grace of God is not something that is deserved or even fair. In our text today, Jesus takes his disciples out of familiar territory and crosses into the foreign lands of Tyre and Sidon. Through an encounter with a Canaanite woman, Jesus reveals a need for grace challenges the boundaries of fairness so others may come to know wholeness. A reading from the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 15, verses 21 to 28. Jesus left that place and went away to the district of Tyre and Sidon. Just then, a Canaanite woman from the region came out and started shouting, "Have mercy on me, Lord, Son of David. My daughter is tormented by a demon." But he did not answer her at all. And his disciples came and urged him, saying, "Send her away, for she keeps shouting after us." He answered, "I was sent only to the lost sheep of the house of Israel." But she came and knelt before him, saying, "Lord, help me." He answered, "It is not fair to take the children's food and throw it to the dogs." She said, "Yes, Lord, yet even the dogs eat the crumbs that fall from their master's table." Then Jesus answered her, "Woman, great is your faith. Let it be done for you as you wish." And her daughter was healed instantly. This is the Gospel of Jesus Christ.
You know, from a young age, if there's an understanding that almost any human being wrestles with, it's got to be the understanding of fairness, of what's fair. I mean, I imagine that there isn't a parent on this earth who hasn't heard a child utter those words, you know, it's not fair. Right? The phrase, it might be spoken in different languages around this world, but I think we can all hear that intonation, right? That whiny tone that delivers the exclamation, it's not fair. And as common and as grating sometimes as that phrase can be, and as certain as hearing it, something else I believe that is certain in this world is that the phrase never goes away. And why is that? Well, I believe it's because the quest for fairness is probably one of the oldest in human existence. I mean, sooner or later, we come to appreciate how life on this earth is not fair. As one wise person once said, I looked up fairness in the dictionary and it wasn't there. I mean, the quest for fairness and the lack of it in this world, it's something that can demoralize even the strongest soul. Because sooner or later, any one of us will find ourselves in a situation where something happens that's beyond our control and beyond our doing. And even in spite of our best efforts, things just don't turn out. We can find ourselves standing, looking at ourselves in a mirror, or looking at the sky or at those around us, and we can be saying or even shouting, it's not fair. I know in my parenting experience, whenever I would hear those words, it's not fair, there were times when I would make these vain appeals to logic, you know, in order to explain to my daughter why something wasn't fair. I mean, maybe explain that, well, she didn't have the opportunity to do that great thing that friend of hers was doing, and that she had gotten to do all sorts of things that her friend hadn't done or wasn't doing. I mean, but I quickly learned that logic doesn't always work when explaining that things are fair or unfair. I mean, usually the response to my explanation to my daughter was a repeat of the phrase, but it isn't fair. You know, as a parent, I truly wanted to reconcile my daughter's feelings about the situation. And so eventually, you know, in order to prepare her for adulthood and for life in this world, eventually I would get to the point when I would confess to my daughter this sad reality, you know, that life, it just isn't fair. But the problem with that response is that you're left with an unhappy child. A child who cannot get beyond the feeling of that unhappiness. I mean, telling a child that life isn't fair, it has zero meaning, especially for perhaps a 7-year-old who doesn't have much life experience under their belt. Although I should add that I've met plenty of adults who don't necessarily understand the reality that life isn't fair either, that life in this world isn't what we would call fair. Now, in our text today that Wayne read for us from the Gospel of Matthew, Jesus encounters a situation where he himself uses this phrase, it is not fair. And it comes when he and his disciples are traveling through this region, the regions of Tyre and Sidon. And these would have been foreign lands to Jesus' disciples. They were north of the Galilee, where the disciples were from. Tyre and Sidon are part of what's now modern-day Lebanon. Now, the text doesn't tell us why Jesus decided to travel to this region, but perhaps he wants to take his disciples on a bit of a field trip. You know, Jesus has been teaching them about the kingdom of God, what life was like in the kingdom, and perhaps by taking them to a different place, it was a chance for them to engage a little more deeply in what it was they were learning about, what Jesus had been teaching them, gain a better understanding of who Jesus is, his mission, and expose them to worlds outside their own. That's what field trips, you know, do. They help students in this way. So this is what Jesus was offering his disciples that day. And we see immediately in this text that the disciples have something to learn as they are approached by this Canaanite woman who begins shouting at them. And more specifically, she's shouting at Jesus because she's looking for Jesus' help in regards to the well-being of her ailing daughter. The woman says her daughter is tormented by a demon. Now, we can't be sure exactly what is meant by this, although we can assume that her daughter is not well. And naturally, the mother is full of concern for her daughter. And we can also assume that this woman believes that Jesus can answer her request and help her daughter. The disciples, however, they don't believe necessarily that Jesus can or should help her. In fact, they say to Jesus, "Send her away," right? They basically see her as someone who is infringing on their time with Jesus, maybe, you know, taking away from their precious time together. I mean, after all, the disciples were the ones who had given up a lot. Some of them, they gave up their livelihoods, everything, to follow Jesus. So why should this woman receive any special attention? I mean, they saw Jesus as the Messiah of the Jews, for him, for them, right? Not for an outsider like this Canaanite woman. They say to Jesus, right, "She's bothering us. Get rid of her." And perhaps this is why Jesus responds to the woman as he does. He responds by saying to her that he had been sent for the lost sheep of Israel. Right? They were outside of Israel at this point. Right? And this would have been in keeping with what the disciples would have believed. Right? Jesus even says to the woman, that phrase, we hear it now, Jesus says to her, "It is not fair to take the children's food and throw it to the dogs." Now, a lot of people have difficulty with this saying of Jesus to the woman, and because it seems rather derogatory that he would basically equate this woman's status or need to that of a dog. I mean, a dog whose hunger for mercy is seen as secondary to the needs of others, let's say his disciples. Except we should keep in mind that the disciples are present, right? And when Jesus says this to the woman, we should imagine the disciples all standing there, you know, listening and nodding their heads, saying, "Exactly, you tell her, Jesus. You're here for us, and it's not fair for her to benefit." I mean, what has she done compared to us? Who is she compared to us? Her situation and that of her daughter were secondary at best when it came to the disciples and when they considered their own needs and their own status. I mean, you see, that's the thing about what's fair and what isn't fair. I mean, usually when we utter the phrase, it's not fair, or we see something as not being fair, it usually has to do with us, or with me, or with people close to me, or people like me. The questions of fairness usually focus on the self. Am I getting a fair shake? Am I getting my due? Am I getting what I deserve? If I'm not getting what I believe I deserve, then it's not fair. It's like an old Calvin and Hobbes cartoon I once read. I love Calvin and Hobbes. And Calvin, he goes to his father and he says, "It isn't fair." And his father's response is, "Well, the world isn't fair, Calvin." And Calvin then exclaims back to his father. He says, "I know." He says, "But why isn't it even unfair in my favor? Why isn't it even unfair in my favor?" You see, this is a part of the problem with the human quest for fairness. We confuse fairness with being favored. I mean, for many, life becomes fair when things happen in our favor. Right? When something does happen, you know, or when someone does you a favor, or you find yourself in a favorable position, chances are you aren't going to be too concerned about the question of fairness. But you know, just because someone does you a favor, puts you in a favorable position, doesn't mean it's fair. I mean, think of some of the news that surfaced this past summer. Yet another government scandal in which contracts and services are awarded to friends, apparent friends and associates, while established processes and protocols that are put in place, you know, to provide transparency and accountability and impartiality, they just get thrown out the window or ignored, right? We're reminded how granting favors in that situation has little to do with being fair or with fairness. I mean, further, you know, when it comes to human understandings of what is fair and of what's not fair, we don't necessarily like it when someone else is favored, you know, or appears to demand or receive special treatment. We just can't handle it sometimes. And this is something that I have noticed with the Black Lives Matter movement. An important movement that we've all heard about it. But you know, I cannot tell you how many times I've heard non-blacks say to me in response to the Black Lives Matter movement by saying, well, don't all lives matter? I mean, hearing the phrase Black Lives Matter can rub people the wrong way because it doesn't seem fair. Right? It's not fair that we should give special focus or attention to a particular group. I mean, my life matters too. The problem is, you see, is that people are confusing fairness with being favored. Right? There's a failure to see clearly how, for the most part, you know, whites have lived in a social and a political system that has been more beneficial towards whites, maintaining white privilege. I mean, whites have enjoyed living in a world that, echoing that Calvin and Hobbes cartoon, has been unfair. But it's been unfair in their favor. The Black Lives Matter movement, in part, exposes this truth and the peril it has caused for blacks, especially within the justice system. Right? It's less about what's fair. This movement, it's not about what's fair and what's not fair. It's more about, there's a need for grace here. The grace required to rectify a situation where black lives have suffered disproportionately. The reality is that, you know, there are times when the needs of one person or one group are greater than another. Right? And in those situations, we can't be worried about what's fair. I mean, let me put it to you another way. Let's say you get in, or someone you know gets into a car accident, and one person has a serious head injury, but others have maybe a few bumps and bruises. Right? The person whose life is at risk gets first priority when it comes to medical care. I mean, that doesn't mean that paramedics don't care about or won't help the other individuals, but the triage places the most dire situation first in line. Right? It's not about what's fair in those situations. It's about saving lives. And understanding that there are times when certain situations and people are more deserving of our attention, of our care, and of our concern. You know, something tells me this is, you know, along the lines of what Jesus wanted his followers to realize in that encounter with the Canaanite woman that day. When Jesus uses the phrase, it's not fair. And when he uses it in his response to this woman, he's expressing what many in his day, including his disciples, would have believed. Right? Even the Canaanite woman in her response doesn't disagree. Her answer to Jesus starts with, yes, Lord. It's not fair. But at the same time, she also knows that whether something is fair or unfair, she is still one who stands in need of some grace. She also knows that Jesus is the one who can give her that grace when she makes her plea for mercy to him. In fact, Jesus, you know, this is interesting in this text. Jesus does just what he just said was unfair. Right in front of the disciples, he says to her, "Woman, great is your faith. Let it be done for you as you wish." And her daughter is healed. Right? Jesus doesn't just give her a crumb that falls from the table. Jesus gives her the gift of grace he embodied in the same way he would offer it to anyone, whether they deserve it or not, whether it's seen as being fair or not. In fact, in this woman's case, Jesus did more for her than he had done for any of his disciples at this point, you know, to our knowledge. You know, and that can hardly seem fair given what they had, you know, given up and left behind. Except you see, when it comes to what is fair in the kingdom of God, the grace of God just isn't fair. But it is free. It's freely given to everyone and anyone, whether one believes it is deserved or not, because God knows we need it to survive in a world and in a life that isn't fair. Because you see, in a world that isn't fair, it is easy to lose faith. The temptation can be to give up on God, to give up on the church, even give up on people or ourselves. Right? And in these times when we can lose faith, in such times, it is only then that grace, it's the grace of God which is beyond us that can break through that wall of fear and despair and feeling sorry for ourselves and that sense of unfairness. Right? Call it the barrier to believing. Believing that some things are just impossible and out of reach. Right? But God's grace can break through that, and everyone needs that kind of grace in their lives. The grace that breaks through those barriers. The barriers we can create when we think life isn't fair. And sooner or later, you know, some of us are going to need this grace, and we're going to need more of it than others. I mean, one author I read described it this way. She used an example of a conversation she had been privy to between a mother and her 6-year-old son. Now, the 6-year-old was in the midst of becoming accustomed to the recent arrival of a baby brother. And one day, as his mother was working on something, you know, she picked up his little brother, held him close to her, was walking around doing her thing, and the 6-year-old was looking at his mother, perhaps wondering why his little brother was more deserving of the extra attention getting to be carried around. And maybe the older brother was wondering if it was fair. And so he asks his mother this question. He says, "Mom, can you pick me up?" Well, at first, you know, she dismissed him by saying, "Well, you're too big to pick up. Besides, you know, I'm carrying your brother." And she continued, though, and she said, "But, you know, I could pick you up if your life depended on it." Well, that, you see, was a new thought to the older brother. But he decided to push his mom a little more, and he said, "Well, could you pick Dad up if his life depended on it?" And the mother, you know, paused for a moment. She said, "Well, yes, if his life depended on it, I could do my best, or I would do my best to pick him up." See, the 6-year-old, when he heard that, he seemed kind of reassured. You know, even though he knew that he wouldn't be carried around the way his little brother was being carried around at the moment, he knew that there was a love and a grace that was there for him when he needed it. You know, as I thought about that story, you know, I thought just, you know, what a difference it could make, right? If we could all have that same reassurance of that such grace in our lives. But you see, this is the difference that Jesus wants to make in this world and in our lives. Especially when things aren't fair. I mean, Jesus knew this world wasn't fair. I mean, there was nothing fair about the way he was treated. There was nothing fair about the way he died on the cross. I mean, when it came to what Jesus gave to this world and what he did in it, what is recorded about him, he certainly didn't get what he deserved. But by faith, you see, his resurrection reveals a grace that comes and a love, a God that is there for us when it is needed most. And I believe, you know, now is one of those times when we especially need this kind of grace the most. You know, during this pandemic time, a time when things aren't fair, we're hearing more about things that aren't fair, things that aren't in our favor. A time when many are led to believe that our lives don't matter. Right? There's a God who works to favor us with a grace and a love that is there for the healing and is there for the health of our souls. It's not fair, this world, but the grace of God is still free. Thanks be to God.
Let us pray. Giver and sustainer of life, we come before you in prayer this day, hopeful in the love you have given us to share, a love that calls us to wholeness and reconciliation, a love that does not dwell on personal needs but seeks to meet the needs of others, a love you revealed in the appearance of Christ Jesus, who calls each of us to new and different living. In Jesus, the true human, we rediscover our common humanity, one that calls us to look at each other as a brother, as a sister, as a sibling in the great family of faith. We're grateful for this time of worship, a moment of praise and gratitude for all that has been graciously given to us, a moment that is needed as the week ahead will be a time when our faith will surely be tested. We will be reminded once again that the world and this life isn't fair. But for now, in this moment, we receive your grace as we grow in faith and grow closer to you. Through difficult times, remind us how you seek to break through barriers, to wrap us with a promise of peace. We sometimes forget as we wince at headlines filled with conflict, with confusion and fear. We can question as we face a serious illness or test results, a difficult decision, or bear a sudden loss or a heavy grief. Yet in ways beyond our ability to comprehend, you not only cradle us in your care, but you give us hope, even in the face of death itself. And so in this grace, we thank you for blessings and kindnesses received. Thank you for hearts that celebrate these blessings and kindnesses with us. And thank you that we can share these gifts with others. Gifts that come in the grandest form of creation to the smallest moments of our daily living. In words of encouragement, a phone call, and listening and a helping hand, we give thanks. O merciful God, grant us the courage to continue to declare knowledge of you and of your love in this world. For you hold us in this world in eternity. You are that constant energy seeking to break forth a new creation. So hear us as we embrace this spirit and pray for others. As we pray for ones who are estranged from spouse or family, friends or neighbors, ones who are isolated or ones who find it difficult to forgive past wrongs done to them. We pray for those who for years have carried feelings of guilt or regret for something they did or something they neglected to do. Ones who find it difficult to ask for forgiveness or forgive themselves. We pray for those who find themselves far away from you, struggling to overcome their doubts or disillusionment, ones who feel hard done by and who wonder how to find their way back. We pray for those watching someone they love trying to cope with a serious illness or injury, ones who long for a miraculous intervention. We pray for many others in this world who are suffering today from grief, loneliness, hunger, poverty, violence or illness or disaster. Sustain all those who look to you in hope. And strengthen us, your people, that we might be a light to all those who find themselves in darkness. Hear us as we pray for ones who seek to bring relief and comfort to others. God, meet us where we are at this moment. Hear us as we offer prayers for those known to us, for places in this world, for our own homes and families, for the needs of strangers. Hear us as we offer you our own prayers of need and concern, those prayers we carry deep within us. Hear our prayers, O Lord, and answer in your love. And remind us of your abiding presence in all that life brings. Remind us of the help you bring and your promise of grace that turns to us and this creation again and again, even when the world seems unfair, and especially when it seems unfair. So transform us by your much needed grace, that we can be made whole, and in wholeness, that we may be the hands and heart of Christ. We pray through the power of his Spirit. Amen. And let us depart this day with the following words. Merciful God, we ask for your blessing. Look with kindness on your people gathered, that we might reflect your goodness to the world around us, that all the nations will come to know your ways and acknowledge your saving power. They will praise you as we praise you now. For you are a God of justice and compassion, abundantly providing for the needs of the world. Bless us, O God, and make us a blessing, that the whole earth may come to experience your abundant grace.
And as we go from this place today, as we leave this sacred time, a time that we had given to God, a time where we let God take care of us, may you know God's care as you enter this world again and this week ahead. With all that remains unknown, with all that may happen, may you know God's presence. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May God's face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May our Lord shower you with kindness and give you peace. Amen.